Hello, I'm Ben Godwin. Welcome to the Word Workshop, recorded at the Good Springs Full Gospel Church.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy.
My wife Michelle and I have pastored the Good Springs Full Gospel Church since 1999, a Spirit-filled church with a hunger for God and a heart for people. Good Springs Full Gospel Church is located in Walker County on Highway 269, 10 miles south of Jasper.
The prophet said that the knowledge of the glory of the Lord will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea.
So prepare your hearts to receive from the Word, because when all else fails, God's Word works.
God is good all the time. God is good. Amen. Praise God. I want to show you a couple things before we dig into the Word. I love this. The only one that can truly satisfy the human heart is the one who made it. Amen. Only Jesus can satisfy your soul. Somebody sent me this. I like it. God wins. Not my, just my name, hallelujah, but how many know in the end God wins? You believe that? I've read the back of the book, and we win. Praise God, amen. If church wasn't important, hell wouldn't fight so hard to keep you from it. Seems like it's always a battle, doesn't it? But we're winners anyway. Praise God. This lap made me crack up. That devil doesn't know what bad is. My granny is a Pentecostal gangsta. Made me laugh. Praise God. And this, I don't know who Lloyd Legalist is, but this made me laugh. Brain cells die, skin cells die, and even hair cells die. But the fat cells in my stomach must have accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, since they seem to have eternal life. It's not fair, is it? Not fair. Well, it's good to laugh. Praise God. I want you to turn with me in your Bibles, if you will, please, to the, I'm not going to call it a book, because it's not a book. It's a letter. Turn with me to the letter of Philemon. If you have no idea where that is in the Bible, let me help you. That's page 1553. In my Bible. Sandwiched between Titus and Hebrews in the New Testament, you'll find Paul's shortest and most personal letter. Paul wrote either 13 or 14 of what we call books, they're actually letters, in the New Testament, depending on if he wrote Hebrews or not. Yet in Philemon's 25 short verses, it contains one of the greatest accounts of God's grace and Christian brotherly love. It's so tiny and obscure, many people overlook it, ignore it, and never bother to read it. You can read this little letter in 5 minutes or less, and yet it contains a wealth of truth that I feel compelled to share with you today. Here's the title of this message: The Pastor, the Prisoner, and the Runaway Slave. The pastor was Philemon. The prisoner was the Apostle Paul. The runaway slave was a man called Onesimus. And I think you're going to learn something interesting about this today. Now, there's different ways of pronouncing this. Some people pronounce it Philemon. How many have heard it pronounced that way? Some people pronounce it Philemon. Some people pronounce it Philemon. Potato, potato, tomato, tomato, pecan, pecan. Makes no difference. Hallelujah. All right. Different strokes for different folks, right? So get over that part. Let's do a little dive into this letter Paul wrote to Philemon. It was handwritten by Paul. Glance down at verse 19. There's only one chapter. Verse 19, I, Paul, am writing with what? My own hand. Oftentimes, Paul would dictate his letters and somebody else would write them down. But this was so personal. It mattered to Paul so much, he took the time to get a piece of papyrus paper and dip that quill pen in ink and write it with his own handwriting from a prison cell. So it was written by Paul. As I mentioned, it is the shortest and most personal of all of his letters. Philemon is a companion to the letter to Colossians, because Philemon lived in Colossae and was actually the pastor of the Colossian church, as we will see. The tone is interesting. This is actually called the polite or the courteous epistle. It's very cordial. It's very pleasant. It's very tender. It's very gracious. I would even use the word diplomatic. Paul was appealing to his friend to do a special favor for him, as will be evident in just a moment. Here's kind of the overarching theme. It's reconciliation, forgiveness, the restoration of a broken relationship. And here's the PowerPoint of the whole text, all right? Christian brotherhood removes all social and class distinctions because we are all one in Jesus Christ. I got a few amens and one that's right. How many are glad in Christ Jesus? There is no male nor female. There is no black, no white. There is no rich. There is no poor. There is no Jew. There is no Gentile. There is no bond. There is no free. We're all one in Jesus Christ. How many know we're covered by the same blood? Our names are written in the same book of life. We're headed for the same heaven. We're going to spend eternity together. So look at somebody and say, we ought to get along down here. Hallelujah. Paul wrote in another place, 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. How many glad you're a new creature? Old things are passed away, and all things have become new. Let me tell you something. The circumstance of your first birth are totally irrelevant. What matters is that you've been born again. How many glad you've been born again? You're part of the family of God. Amen and amen. I want you to notice what Paul calls himself. He calls himself this in the first verse. Look at it with me. Paul, a what? A prisoner of Christ Jesus. And Timothy, our brother, if you glance down to verse 9, you'll see the last line where he says, and now also a prisoner of Jesus Christ. He calls himself a prisoner of Jesus Christ twice here in Philemon. He also calls himself that twice in the book of Ephesians and once in the book of 2 Timothy. So five times in Paul's writings, he calls himself the prisoner of Jesus Christ. He doesn't call himself the prisoner of Rome. He doesn't call himself the prisoner of Nero, which he technically actually was. But he calls himself the prisoner of Jesus Christ. In other words, Rome is not in control of my fate. Nero does not have the final say in my life. I'm a prisoner of Jesus Christ. He has the final verdict in the affairs of my life. How many are glad God is in control? Hallelujah. That was Paul's way of saying God is in control. My life is in his hands, not man's hands. All right, let's break down this for a moment. Who was Philemon? Philemon, his name means friendly and affectionate. Beautiful name. He was a convert of Paul's who pastored the Colossian church in his house. Look at verse 2 with me. He says, to Philemon, our beloved friend and fellow laborer, verse 1, then to verse 2, he says, to the beloved Apphia, that's believed to be Philemon's wife, and Archippus, which is believed to be his son, our fellow soldier, and notice this phrase, to the church, where? In your house. You understand? Jews had synagogues that they met in. But Christians did not have church buildings. Often they met in open air, wherever they could meet, but often they would meet in someone's house. They didn't start building Christian church buildings until Constantine embrace Christianity, 313 AD. So for the first couple of centuries of Christendom, they didn't have church buildings. They met in people's homes. But how many know the same God, hallelujah, who was there on the day of Pentecost, was in every one of those meetings, and he's the same God today. The church is not a building. The church is wherever God is. Oh, I need to say that again. The church is not a building. God said, I dwell not in temples made with hands. This is just a gathering place. This is just where we come to rally. But the church is wherever God dwells within his people. Amen. By the way, the word church comes from a Greek word, ekklesia, which means the called out ones. How many glad you've been called out? Called out of darkness and into his marvelous light. You're part of the church. So the church in Colossae met in Philemon's house. Let's look at a couple more facts about Philemon here. He was a wealthy man who was kind and generous to the saints. Look at verse 3, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 4, thank my God making mention of you always in my prayers, hearing of your love and faith which you have toward the Lord Jesus and toward all the saints. He was very benevolent. He was very giving, very generous. Verse 6, that the sharing of your faith may become effective by the acknowledgement of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. For we have great joy and consolation in your love because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed by you, brother. The King James says the bowels of the saints. It just means your heart. He was touching people's lives with not only the word of the gospel, but the example of Jesus in showing Christian love. Here's another thing I wanted to point out about Philemon. Church tradition says he was stoned with his wife Apphia and his son Archippus in 2 Colossians 4:17. There, Paul calls, he says this, he says, take heed to the ministry which you have received in the Lord that you may fulfill it. And he calls Archippus by name there. So they're interrelated. The book of Colossians, the book of Philemon, these letters, they're interrelated because it happened at the same place. It was written at the same time, sent at the same time, and it was intended for the same people. If you're with me so far, say, yay, brother. All right, now, who was Onesimus? I'm glad you asked, because I'm going to tell you all about it. Praise God. That's the whole point of this letter, is because of Onesimus. Who was Onesimus? Let's look into his life for a minute. Onesimus, his name means useful or profitable. Look at verse 11. Paul says, who was once unprofitable, in other words, he didn't live up to his name, to you, but is now profitable to you and to me. That's Onesimus. Here's another thing. He was a fugitive, probably a thief. Look down at verse 18. But if he has wronged you or owes you anything, put that on my account, Paul says. So here's what happens. Onesimus runs away from Colossae. He makes a long journey and meets with the Apostle Paul in Rome, where Paul converts him, leads him to Jesus. We know this because of what Paul said. Look at verse 10 with me, if you will, please. I appeal to you for my son. He calls him my son, Onesimus, whom I have begotten while in my chains. In other words, I led him to Jesus. I led him to the Lord while I was right here in this prison cell. Paul may have been confined, but how many know the word of God is not bound? You may be confined in some of your situations, some of your circumstances in your life, but the power of God is not limited. Hallelujah. God can reach any kind of people if we're a willing vessel. Amen? Well, hallelujah. Couple more things about Onesimus here. Paul calls him in Colossians 4:9 a faithful and beloved brother. Notice he doesn't refer to him as a slave. He refers to him as a brother. And then after he spent some time with the Apostle Paul, the dreaded day comes. Because legally and technically, Paul had to send him back home. Paul had to send him back home. How many know in order to be right with God, we've got to make an effort to be right with people? And Onesimus had done something wrong, and he had to be reconciled and restored back to his master. Look at this scripture. Matthew 5, verse 23 and 24. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, do what? Leave your gift at the altar, and what? First, be reconciled to your brother, then come and offer your gift. In other words, if there's something between you and somebody, you need to work that out, because it can be a barrier and a hindrance between you and God. How many know our vertical relationship with God should affect our horizontal relationships with other people? If we're right with God, we're going to try to make an attempt to be right with other people. Now, some people, it's rather difficult, isn't it? You remember the poem, "To live above with saints we love, that will be grace and glory. But to live below with saints we know, now that's another story." And here's my answer to those difficult people in your life that are hard to deal with. Some people you have to love from a distance. They're like hugging a cactus. You try to get close to them, and what happens? You get hurt. So you forgive, you love, and listen, even if they've mistreated you or done you wrong, you forgive them. It doesn't mean you open the door and let them ruin your life. You keep healthy boundaries in place. And you love them. Amen. But if you're right with God, you're going to attempt to be right with people. Good preaching, Brother Ben. I know you drove all the way to church just to hear that, didn't you? Now, let's address the elephant in the room, and that is the issue of slavery. Slavery was very common in Bible times, but I want to say this. Slavery is an evil practice in any age, among any race. It was sadly a common reality in Bible times. Did you know this? Did you know it is estimated that one out of every three people were enslaved in the ancient Roman Empire? And it wasn't just one race. It was across the board, multiple races. And notice the rest of that. Sin is a form of slavery. Sin results in spiritual slavery to Satan, but whom the Son sets free is free indeed. How many glad you're not a slave anymore? Hallelujah. Oh yeah, before we were saved, we were dominated. We were controlled by the sin nature. But Paul wrote and he said, sin shall no longer have dominion over you, because you're not under the law, you're under grace. That doesn't mean you're sinless. Doesn't mean you can't sin or you don't sin. What it means is it doesn't control your life anymore. Woo, isn't that good news? The best illustration I've ever come up with is Pinocchio. What was Pinocchio before he became a real boy? Remember, he was a marionette. You know what a marionette is, right? That's a puppet. The puppet master manipulates his arms and his legs and his movements. He's not controlling himself. He's being controlled by someone else. That's how we were before we were saved. We were controlled by sin. We were controlled by Satan, manipulated through the flesh. But aren't you glad the moment you knelt to the cross, Jesus cut the strings. Hallelujah. I said, Jesus cut the strings. I've got a new puppet master. Hallelujah. It's not the flesh, it's not sin, it's not Satan. Jesus is my master. Glory to God. Well, I'm going to preach myself happy up here. Slavery is an evil practice, but it was very, very common in Bible times. The Bible does not condone slavery. It simply recognizes that slavery was part of ancient culture. Biblical truth stands in opposition to slavery. Did you know this? This was sobering. Michelle and I went and watched that movie. The movie that Jim Caviezel's in, The Sound of Freedom. And boy, you talk about sobering. You talk about gripping. They don't get overly graphic, which I was very thankful for. But it dealt with the issue of human trafficking and sex slavery that is prominent. Did you know this? There are more people enslaved now of all races than when slavery was legal. It has become a global epidemic. People being abducted, people being sold either into slave labor, sweatshops, or into sex, the sex industry. It is an epidemic worldwide. And when we watched that movie, it was powerful how this man, he tracked through South America and helped liberate a boy and a girl, that, brother and sister, that had been abducted and taken into slavery. Powerful story. If you get a chance to watch it, it's called The Sound of Freedom. Powerful, powerful film. Anyway, Paul sent this letter back to Philemon because he knew what was ahead for Onesimus. They didn't treat slaves very nice. A runaway slave under Roman law could be executed, could be punished severely, maybe flogged, maybe branded with a hot branding iron as a fugitive, could be crucified as an example. And here's what Paul says. It's time to go home, Onesimus. I want you to go back to your master. But I'm not leaving you. I'm not sending you empty-handed. I'm sending you home with a letter. I'm sending you home with an appeal to your master. Not to treat you as a slave, but to treat you as a brother. Whew, hallelujah. And I want you to see, Paul asked for five specific requests. This is where we see ourselves in the story. Because how many know we're all runaways? All we like sheep have gone astray. Every one of us have turned to our own way. We've all run from our benevolent master. Hallelujah. But how many can hear his voice saying, come home? How many are glad he's called you back? Oh yeah, hallelujah. I'm coming home. Praise God. Doesn't matter how far you've run from him. Come home today. And he will restore you and he will renew you. Look at this. This is five requests that Paul made to Philemon. And it mirrors the intercession of Christ for us. The way Paul intercedes for Onesimus is similar to how Christ intercedes for us. Oh, by the way, in Hebrews 7:25, the Bible says that we have a high priest who ever lives to make intercession for us. Come back to me for a minute. I want to explain this part. Think about this. The Bible says that Jesus is seated at the right hand of the throne of God, and what's he doing? Look at somebody say, he's praying for you. Doesn't that make you feel better to know Jesus is praying for you? Not only that, the Holy Spirit is also our advocate, our comforter, who stands by our side, who intercedes according to the will of God. That means we've got two on our side, plus a host of angels. Hallelujah. How many believe it's gonna turn out well for us? Yeah. Man, if you're in a legal fix, it's good to have a lawyer, isn't it? Even better to have two. Well, praise God. If any man sin, we have an advocate, a defense attorney with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sin, and not for our sin only, but for the sins of the whole world. We've got an advocate. Tell somebody, I've got a lawyer. Hallelujah. Not just one lawyer, I've got two lawyers. I've got the Holy Spirit standing by my side in my corner to defend me. Praise God. Now let's look at five specific requests that Paul made to Philemon that mirror what Jesus is interceding for us about. Number one, he says, accept Onesimus back. Look at verse 8. Therefore, though I might be very bold in Christ to, I think the King James says, enjoin you or command you. Verse 9, yet for love's sake, I rather beseech you. That means beg, plead, appeal to you. Being such a one as Paul, the aged. Even Paul made fun of his age. That means over 60 at least. And now also a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Verse 10, I appeal to you for my son, Onesimus, whom I have begotten while in my chains, who was once unprofitable to you, but now is profitable to you and to me. I am sending him back. You therefore, read it with me, receive him, that is my own heart. He says, take him back. Can't you hear the voice of Jesus interceding to the Father when we have drifted into sin and drifted into temptation and drifted into our own stubborn will? And God says, or Jesus says to the Father, take him back. Bring them back home where they belong. Bring them back into right relationship with you. I'm gonna glad God has accepted you back. Oh yes, hallelujah. Even though Onesimus didn't live up to his name, useful or profitable, he's now a changed man. How many times have we run from God, but Jesus persuaded the Father to take us back with open arms? Thank you, Jesus. Here's the second request Paul gives to Philemon. Treat Onesimus as a brother. Look at verse 13. Whom I wish to keep. Paul says he's such an asset. He's such a profitable helper. I'd love to keep him right here with me. That on your behalf he might minister to me in my chains for the gospel. He's a big help. Verse 14, but without your consent, I want to do nothing that your good deed might not be by compulsion, as it were, but voluntary. In other words, I'm not coercing you. I'm not commanding you. I'm not demanding. I want you to do this voluntarily. Verse 15, for perhaps he departed for a while for this purpose, that you might receive him forever. In other words, you're going to be restored and y'all are going to work together the remainder of your days. Look at verse 16. He says, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. Don't beat him. Don't punish him. Don't put him in chains. Don't put him in probation. Don't put him in the doghouse. Don't give him what he deserves. Forgive him and treat him like a brother and not like a slave. How many are glad God doesn't treat us like we deserve? Somebody said it this way, that grace is when God does not give us what we deserve. Thank God for grace. Thank God for mercy. When we return to God, he doesn't treat us as second-class citizens. He treats us as sons and daughters, as heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ Jesus. He restores our seat at the table. Paul ups the ante even more. Look at this. Not only do I want you to accept him back, not only do I want you to treat him as a brother, I want you to treat Onesimus as you would treat me. Look at verse 17. If then you count me as a partner, what? Receive him as you would me. Roll out the red carpet. Prepare a feast. Throw a party. Welcome Onesimus home just like you would welcome me, the esteemed apostle Paul. I hope you're seeing what I'm getting to. How are we treated in the presence of God? We are just as accepted in the presence of God as Jesus Christ, the firstborn son. He says, Daddy, don't treat them like they deserve. No, you treat them just like you treat me. With favor, with kindness, with grace. Whew. Are you seeing the picture here? That's royal treatment. Wow. Here's the fourth request. Paul writes, he says, put Onesimus's debt on my account. Look at verse 18. But if he has wronged you, implying that he has, or if he owes you anything, put that on my account. It's believed that Onesimus probably stole something because he had no wherewithal, he had no funds, and he's making a trip 1,000 miles away to go to the Apostle Paul in Rome. You got to get ship fare, you got to have food, lodging, you got to have money to do that. So it's believed that he stole either money from his master or he stole a possession and sold it, pawned it, whatever, so that he could fund his trip to go find the Apostle Paul. And Paul says, if he's wronged you, I want you to put it on my account. Look at verse 19. I, Paul, am writing with my own hand. I will repay. Not to mention to you that you owe me even your own self besides. That's a little leverage Paul uses right there. What's Paul really saying? He's saying, Philemon, if it wasn't for me, You'd be a dead man. If it wasn't for me, you'd either be lost or you'd have died in your sins and be in hell forever. You owe me your whole life, buddy. So surely you can do a little favor for me in return. You scratch my back, I'll scratch your back. Hallelujah. But Paul said, if he's wronged you, forget about it. Just put it on my tab. I'll pay the bill when I come. Put it on my credit card. Hallelujah. I'll pay the bill. How many glad Jesus paid your debt? How many glad Jesus paid your sin debt? Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He owed a debt he did not owe. Or I owed a debt I could not pay. I needed someone to wash my sins away. And now I sing a brand new song, Amazing Grace. Christ Jesus paid the debt that I could never pay. Tell somebody your sin debt's been paid. I've told this 100 times. I'm going to tell it 100 more before Jesus takes me home. Jesus' last 3 words from the cross. It is finished. In the English, that's a 3-word phrase. In the Greek, it's 1 word, tetelestai. You know what it means? Paid in full. Paid in full. I need to say it again. Paid in full. Archaeologists have found tax receipts with tetelestai stamped on them, men indicating a zero balance, paid in full. How many can rejoice today and say, he paid my debt in full? Hallelujah. I don't owe a thing because he paid it all. Put it on my account. I'll take care of the bill. Woo, thank you, Jesus. Number 5, we're going to land this plane, folks, in just a minute. Here's number 5. Paul says, prepare a place for me, a guest room. Look at verse 20. Yes, brother, let me have joy from you in the Lord, refreshed. Refresh my heart in the Lord, having confidence in your obedience. I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. You're not just going to do the bare minimum. I believe you're going to do above and beyond. And then look what he says here. Verse 22, but meanwhile also prepare a guest room for me, for I trust that through your prayers I shall be granted to you. In other words, Paul says, get the guest suite available. Get it cleaned up. I'm coming. Well, Paul never made it. History shows us, Paul, that there's no evidence Paul ever made it to Colossae. But he said, you make me a room. You prepare a place. Doesn't that remind you of another promise Jesus made? I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. How many know heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people? How many are preparing? Amen. I'm preparing, amen. Those who fail to prepare, prepare to fail. I am preparing for that place that he is preparing for us. Brother Barry's been working on it 2,000 years. Man, what a place it must be. Well, hallelujah. All right, honey, I need you to do it. Time to land that plane. All right, here you go now. Think about this. I want you to think about the time comes when Paul sends Onesimus back to Philemon. It was a long journey from Rome to Colossae, over 1,000 miles. He's got to catch some ships. Can you imagine days of walking or riding a donkey or whatever he had? And Onesimus is dreading this confrontation with his master. While he's making this journey back to Colossae, back to his master Philemon, can you imagine him rehearsing what he's going to say over and over in his head? Closer he gets to Colossae, the more he's sweating this reunion. He's got to face the facts, face the music. He's got to man up. Finally, he approaches Philemon's house, his old place there. Knots in his stomach. And when their eyes meet for the first time in months, Onesimus surely bows his head. Maybe he falls to his knees. Then put that graphic back up. Here's what he does. He says, before you say anything, before you do anything, Master, Paul said, read this first. I've got a letter. How many have got a letter? How many got an endorsement? Hallelujah. How many have got somebody vouching for you in your corner? Tell somebody it's going to be all right. Hallelujah. It's going to be all right. Praise God. Listen to what happens here. Philemon, this is an amazing, this is a remarkable story of God's grace. Philemon, a slave owner, Onesimus, a runaway slave, embrace as brothers in Christ. According to legend, Onesimus was granted his freedom and he became the bishop, the pastor of the church in Berea. A former runaway slave is now born again. He's forgiven. He's restored. He's reinstated. And then he's freed. And he becomes a brother in Christ and a spiritual leader in the church. And was later martyred for his faith and his testimony of Jesus Christ. That's what grace can do. That's what God can do in a life. Hallelujah. How many know God is a master at turning things around and bringing good out of any bad situation? I need to remind somebody today, every miracle in the Bible started with a problem. Anybody got a problem today? Anybody got a crisis today? Anybody got some issues in your life today? Well, you're a candidate for a miracle. Hallelujah. Impossibilities with men are opportunities to God. Hallelujah. Thankfully, years down the line, there was another emancipator. There was another liberator named Abraham Lincoln who signed the Emancipation Proclamation. And we're still struggling. We're still trying to get there. But we believe all men are created equal. We believe everyone is important in God's sight. We believe the ground is level at the cross. There's no big I's and little U's. We all desperately need the grace of God. And we're all brothers and sisters washed in the blood of Jesus. Will you stand with me this morning? Hallelujah. If you're free today, not only legally and not only nationally, but you're free spiritually, you ought to lift your hand to heaven and thank God you've been set free. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that we're free today. Free to enjoy a walk with you. Free to enjoy fellowship with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you, Lord, for this little letter that made it in the New Testament. It's a reminder of what your grace can do. It's a reminder of how you can heal broken relationships. It's a reminder, oh God, of the power of your grace that we all desperately need. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Brother Dave, you wanted some prayer cloths. Come on, brother, but there are others. Hello everyone, this is Pastor Ben Godwin, thanking you for watching our broadcast today. I pray it has been a blessing and a source of spiritual enrichment for you and your family. I'd like to invite you to visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel, where you can view many more singing and preaching videos. Search for Good Springs Full Gospel Church at youtube.com. Also, please visit our website at goodspringsfgc.org. where you can learn more about our church and ministry, read many of my articles on a variety of subjects, find a direct link to our YouTube channel, shop our online store, and donate to our church and help support our TV ministry with debit, credit card, or PayPal. Also, you can mail in an offering the old-fashioned way to Good Springs Full Gospel Church, P.O. Box 3161, Jasper, Alabama 35502. We can assist you in any way in your spiritual journey. Please contact us. And remember, when all else fails, God's word works.